Why is there suffering?
Oh, well, if you go back to Buddha, we have suffering because we have attachments.
Yeah.
As long as we have attachments, we're going to be suffering. So we have to get rid of our attachments. And so you can go into your attachments and get rid of it. But although, the interesting thing about suffering is that we find people, contemporary people, particularly in a couple religions, who want their suffering. They believe that they have to suffer to be a valid human being. And I've been called a non-human being because I don't suffer.
So, are you a bird then?
I don't know. But I mean, this belief that we have to suffer, and it's really deeply embedded, especially in Christianity, but not just Christianity. You know Christianity better than almost anybody, you know. And that there is this suffering that you have to get to purify yourself. And for me, there's a point at which you had to have suffered a lot. We've talked about this before, both of us have. And that really drives you forward to get rid of suffering. And the people who are saying, I want more suffering, I don't think you've really suffered. And if you want your suffering, it's not suffering anymore. It's called masochism.
Yeah. And really, so then what you're saying is that, you know, if we... not okay, so why is there suffering? Suffering emerges because of attachments. Attachments involve the idea that we are separate.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also the why question is like, well, why is there suffering in the world? This is like basically the question of the book of Job. But you seem to be suggesting, and this has definitely been my experience, that suffering is really a form of teaching.
Mm-hmm.
And so therefore, not to be eschewed necessarily, we don't say, oh, suffering is bad, you know, mm-hmm. all suffering should be removed.
Mm-hmm.
But nor do we love it. We're not, we don't, you know, hold on to our suffering as being proof of some legitimacy
mm-hmm.
or authenticity. I said, it's the occasion to be taught something.
Mm-hmm.
Suffering is always an occasion to be taught.
Mm-hmm.
And speaking personally, that the less I have the gesture vis-a-vis suffering of saying, trying to push it away,
mm-hmm.
and the more I'm able to welcome it mm-hmm. as something that, well, my operating system must need to be rewritten in some mm-hmm. fundamental way.
Mm-hmm.
What precisely is being called forth in this suffering? Where is the suffering? Where is the inflammation, as it were?
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, why suffering means because the answer to why suffering is so that we can learn.
But, and you've gone through some extreme suffering, even recently.
Yeah.
Extreme suffering. And so, you know, you wonder, you know, how you look at the book of Job,
yeah.
how you look at the Christian view of suffering in light of this tremendous suffering you've had recently.
Well, it's interesting, you know, because I started work on a project on the book of Job, and then I was promptly struck with shingles and some post-shingles experience with a lot of pain, you know, and it's right. uncannily like Job. And what's interesting about it is that, you know, we have this view in the Old Testament, so-called, and New Testament traditions, that suffering is a judgment, right? And in fact, this is the mistake that Job's friends come and accuse him of, saying, "Look, well, you must have done something wrong."
Yeah, exactly, you're suffering.
Right, and that a lot of suffering, if we look at our suffering, as opposed to the pain, is really a story,
mm-hmm.
and the story is calling out some aspect of ourself that thinks that we have done something wrong,
mm-hmm.
essentially.
Mm-hmm.
But what's really interesting about a big, long bout of suffering is that you can see that it actually doesn't make any sense. There's no... the why
there's
is...
There's no reason.
No, there's no reason for it, except for the fact that whatever limitations one has for one's ability to process pain, for example,
mm-hmm.
or process grief or process loss,
mm-hmm.
then there is suffering.
Mm-hmm.
But the suffering is not in the grief or the loss or the pain. And so one of the things that one learns is that don't try to figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
Don't try to figure out the suffering. There's no figuring out the suffering. Job's friends come from afar and try to help him figure it out, and he's just basically telling them, would you just go away, please? Because you're not helping matters at all. But it also, I think, I was thinking about this morning, that even though they're very different traditions, the book of Job is in part about the limitations of the jnana path of yoga alone.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can know all day, that your true nature is that you are nothing other than a being of grace, right, as it were. But if you don't experience that, mm-hmm, beyond knowledge in some ways, and that means really loving your fate, you know, amor fati in the, mm-hmm, Greek sense, loving whatever it is cosmos dishes out for you in this bhakti way,
right,
it gives you an angle on your suffering that knowledge alone does not.
Absolutely, and this is in the Bhagavad Gita, and we've talked about this where, I mean, jnana isn't enough, you say, because you intellectually you can come to all kinds of conclusions. If you haven't actually experienced it and, you know, come to a bhakti presence where you need to let go and love completely into the oneness, and to surrender, be actually absorbed into the oneness, then you completely miss out on the deepening of that. And this is one of the I think, challenges people have that have a non-God-based religion, that they have no higher being, is that they don't have any vehicle to be absorbed by or absorbed into and surrender completely to. I think that's one of the big problems you've got, because then you don't, from the jnani perspective, you just don't get there. And the same with karma. And karma is another leg, which says surrender the results of your actions. Just let go of your actions. And I think those three legs all have to be part of the same stool, or the stool tips over.
Yeah. So why suffering is because there's still something there to be surrendered.
Exactly. Yeah.
And the analogy I often come to is I think it's a bell jar, right? You know, where you remove oxygen from a closed, mm-hmm, container, mm-hmm, and it asymptotically approaches being a pure vacuum. Mm-hmm. But there's always a couple of little right, molecules of oxygen in there every now and then. And so any time that one, if one is engaging in a daily practice, and that any time one comes into a spate of suffering, it can cause episodes of doubt, because you say, oh, has this whole thing been a sham? Or is it that, wow, I'm really being taught something here?
Yes.
And I can say with no BS here that, you know, a very difficult 6 weeks that I went to, I'm incredibly grateful for it. I mean, the deepening, mm-hmm, of the experience of this, mm-hmm, that has occurred as a result of really getting down there with the little bits of attachment that are there, attachment to the body, identification with the body. Mm-hmm. As far as my experience goes, there's no other way, mm-hmm, to get there, mm-hmm, besides profound, intense, mm-hmm, suffering, so that it operates as a sort of search engine, mm-hmm, as to how to relieve the suffering.
And, well, you know, what hasn't been surrendered yet?
Exactly.
What is still there that's your attachment to? Tiny, yeah, as it might be.
Yeah.
It's hunting out that last little fragment.
It doesn't even matter how small it is.
No, it isn't. No.
And in a way, I have a feeling, you know, as there gets to be fewer and fewer of them, that the intensity is in some ways greater and greater. Mm. Because by definition, that hasn't been brought into your awareness,
yeah,
yet.
But you have found it deepening.
Oh, profoundly deepening.
Profoundly deepening,
yeah,
to go through this pain.
Yeah, I mean, I started off thinking that I would, you know, write a book that helped explain the Book of Job. Mm-hmm. But in fact, I found that what I was doing was enacting.
becoming Job
and enacting the Book of Job, and really seeing, like, oh, you know, and again, beautifully deepening that this is a teaching, you know, that that every single challenge that we come into, even if it doesn't seem like that at first, mm-hmm, and even if in the depths of it, it's very difficult to be grateful for it, mm-hmm, that one is grateful.
Yeah.
Because whatever was there that needed to be released, it's just that one more occasion, yeah, to let go.
But again, I think an important component of this suffering is that it's involuntary. I mean, you yes, aren't going around looking for something to suffer through. I mean, it has to be something you really do not want, involuntarily imposed upon you, and runs you to the very edge of your capability.
Yeah, I mean, I can say that it broke me,
yeah,
productively. That I came to realize, you know, that no matter how much practice you have, no matter how good you feel most of the time, it's all, you're all riding on a kind of wave of grace, mm-hmm. and whatever is occurring is that wave of grace. And if you need to fall to pieces, that is the spiritual practice, to fall to pieces and to experience the fact that there's nobody there to show up to put the pieces back together again. Mm-hmm.